Hello, my name's Kamalamani, and the subject tonight is love, in the words of Hafiz, the 14th century Persian poet. Because I'd like to talk about unbounded love and our reproductive choices as part of the Buddhist Action Month theme of caring for others. So I'll begin with this image, this rather lovely image of a woman holding the earth, holding a globe, as if she were holding her cherished newborn child. So she's gazing, she's got that gaze of a mother holding her child and holding the earth very close to her, that we intuitively do. We hold babies close to our chest so they can hear our heartbeat. And here she's holding the earth close to her to hear the heartbeat, to feel the warmth of connection. And this is an image which is very close to my heart at the moment, because it's the cover image of my latest book called Other Than Mother, Choosing Childlessness with Life in Mind, which explores voluntary childlessness, and particularly exploring how we can live a creative, nurturing life without actually producing an earthling. So a really important subject, quite a hot subject. And for me, that preparation has been a 14-year of a labour of love, really, in looking at one particular way of expressing the Bodhisattva ideal and letting that sort of take root and blossom in our own lives. And when I look at this image, I'm reminded afresh of the words from the Metta Sutta, verses about loving kindness from the Buddhist tradition. And I'll read a bit from these ancient verses. May everything that lives be well, weak or strong, large or small, seen or unseen, here or elsewhere, present or to come, in heights or depths, may all be well. Have that mind for all the world. Get rid of lies and pride. A mother's mind for her baby, her love, but now unbounded. Secure this mind of love. Now, I particularly love the phrase, a mother's mind for her baby, her love, but now unbounded. Secure this mind of love. That part of the Metta Sutta, it always thrills me. You can tell because I'm getting quite, excited. It's somehow imagining the awesome, boundless power of all the unconditional love of all the mothers, let's say all the fathers too. In fact, anyone really who cares about the next generation and who cares for new life and life on earth, kind of being detonated, this unconditional love being detonated like a bomb of love, a force for good in the world. And it never fails to make me grin, and in this case, giggle slightly. But what has unbounded love got to do with caring for others and reproductive choices and Buddhist Action Month? Well, the original invitation for this talk was to talk about the Bodhisattva ideal, those beings who vow to gain enlightenment for the sake of all that lives. And I'm always very happy to talk about Bodhisattvas. But these days I'm even more curious about talking about Bodhisattvas in terms of the Eco-Sattva. So I'll read what John Stanley and David Loy have to say about Eco-Sattvas by means of introduction. As the Buddha's enlightenment reminds us, our awakening too is linked to the earth. The earth bore witness to the Buddha. And now the earth needs us to bear witness to its dhyana, its steadfastness, the matrix of support it continually provides for living beings. New types of bodhisattvas, eco-sattvas, are needed, who combine the practice of self-transformation with devotion to social and ecological transformation. And there are lots of ways in which we can practice self-transformation and devotion to social and ecological transformation. And I've no doubt that many of you listening are already doing this anyway. And how I understand Stanley and Loy's point is that in this anthropocentric age, in this age where humans are having a more significant impact upon the biosphere compared to other geological ages, we kind of need to bear in mind and kind of need to right our relationship with the world and other than human life. And we need to do that quite urgently. And I'm sure it won't be news to most of you listening that humans aren't living sustainably. and with a mindful awareness of Earth and finite resources. In terms of our average carbon footprints per capita here in the UK, we're living as if there are four planets. And in the United States, that figure rises to eight planets, rather than the one we actually have. So this runaway consuming of our everyday lives, combined with world population, is quite literally costing the Earth. And it's time to act. Most of us probably know what we can do if you want to engage with this, but it's harder to make the changes sometimes, isn't it? As we know from Dharma practice, old habits can die hard, samskaras can be very deeply rooted, and we can't always be so sure that trouble is afoot in terms of climate change and the sixth extinction crisis. And maybe we don't want to change, which is also very human and understandable. We want change, but we don't want to be the ones doing it. So we probably know we could stop flying or fly less, and generally stop travelling around as much as we'd like to do. We might turn down the thermometer in our houses if we live in a colder climate and insulate our houses better, buy less, buy locally, move from being a vegetarian to a vegan. And we also know probably that we could raise awareness, campaign, join together and advocate for policy changes, bearing in mind the different types of action that are now needed as we begin to bear witness to the effect of climate change, maybe climate chaos actually, the refugee crisis, the sixth mass extinction crisis of other than human species, and the glaring disparities between those who have and those who have not. And for those of us who haven't got children, we might also think carefully about whether or not to procreate. This is a hot topic, it's quite a taboo subject, and it's a sensitive topic too, given that probably some of you listening won't have been able to have children, or who've had children who have died. It's a subject we shy away from, I think, because of its very emotive nature. And it's an area in which we can be influenced by very strong pronatal messages at times, which can make it quite hard to think about clearly. And it's also seen as a subject which is in the private realm of home and relationship, when in fact it's a private decision with very global consequences. And it's easy to think, isn't it, sometimes that our actions don't have consequences, but as Dharma practitioners we know that just isn't the case. So those decisions we make have a big impact, small decisions, big decisions. And through my ordination process in my mid-20s, early 30s, I thought a lot about the decision whether or not to have children, having assumed that I'd always become a mother one day. And gradually, over time, it just made less and less sense to me, particularly with the Bodhisattva Ideal in mind. It just made less sense to me to not to have children, partly because other things took priority, but partly with other than human life in mind. So as we move towards the end of this talk, I'm reminded again of the woman here gazing at the world and just thinking how hard it is sometimes to stop and look and to really see, to really know the consequences of our actions. Because when we look at the world, we see all sorts, don't we? All the worldly winds are blowing. So maybe we can call to mind Tara, symbolically the archetypal virgin, mother and queen, as we look at the world. And remembering to bear in mind Tara's legs, one leg up in meditation posture and one leg stepping to help all sentient beings. And as we look at our own tendencies, seeing whether our comfort zone is in meditating or whether our comfort zone is campaigning on the streets, really striking a balance with her legs in mind. You know, how do we keep practicing but take action? And where is our sort of working edge in the sort of action that we take? And still feeling the sense of urgency of the situation in hand at the moment, responding to our own cries and the cries of the world. And I think it's really important that we keep gazing at the world, drinking it in appreciatively. Otherwise, we'll run the risk of not seeing the beauty and not feeling that sense of awe for life on Earth in all its amazing manifestations. So a challenge, or maybe a call to action for this Buddhist Action Month, is maybe just taking the time yourself to maybe imagine, a bit like this woman, you're holding the world in your hands, or going to a favourite place, maybe a particular landscape or seascape, and dwelling on the world as it is right now, the world, all of human life, all of other than human life, a little bit like the last stage of the metta bhavana, of the loving kindness meditation. And with that in mind, just bringing to mind a commitment to a specific action you want to take this month, which has a consequence for the whole world. But try and make it quite specific, because then it's easier to stick to, I think. And also, yeah, keep in mind Greentara's legs again, that sense of balance in meditation and engaging with what's in front of us. And if you're thinking of having a child, or maybe a second or a third or a fourth child, you might bear in mind the wise words of the ecological activist and author and fellow of the Post Carbon Institute, Stephanie Mills, who very pithily says, "Search your conscience and follow your heart." So I wish you a very fruitful Buddhist Action Month for 2016.